friends, Pastor Dean here again greeting you, and so glad that you can join us for these worship occasions. Today our focus is going to be that about Lazarus in the tomb, and again in a very appropriate time for us as we're going through these very weary days. A couple of announcements to share with you. Again, greatly appreciate the prayers that are being uplifted within our congregation. Just so you know, this upcoming week, our staff and our leadership are reaching out to members in our congregation, and so that we hope you will be contacted soon. If you have certain prayer needs or concerns, please make those apparent. We want to hear how you are doing. Again, it is so important that we stay connected during this time, and we do know that our Lord is there to bind us up in love and in His Spirit. And so, blessings to you as we gather this day in worship. Let us now gather around these holy words. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who is present, who gives life, who calls into existence the things that do not exist. Amen. Our hymn this day, as we begin our worship time together, is Tree of Life, an Awesome Mystery. Join together in our gospel acclamation.
Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord. Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord. Save us as you promised. Let your steadfast love come to us, O Lord.
Our Holy Gospel, the Gospel according to St. John, the 11th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. And Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sister sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "The illness does not lead to death, rather it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Well, accordingly, though, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. After having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he'll be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that they were referring to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." And Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called Sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. And when Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt down at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But others said to him, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Didn't I tell you, if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." And when he said this, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Dear friends in Christ, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and our Savior Jesus. Amen. Have you ever worked one of those puzzles that are like a maze? Sometimes they're like a labyrinth in a circle, sometimes they are square in size, and you start to put your pencil in there at the starting point, and what do? You start to go down the path, right? And all of a sudden you get to that path and you discover that it is a dead end, right? And so you start to turn around and go back down the other way, and you try to find another route, and of course that leads you to what? Another dead end, right? Well, you try multiple times, each time tracing, retracing, trying to figure out where you're at, and finally, you might emerge from that puzzle, that maze. Well, life in which we find ourselves today feels like a maze, does it not? Take, for example, this past week. I went grocery shopping, and I know a number of you have gone grocery shopping. And as I went grocery shopping, it was like I was a life-size player in a maze game, because I found myself going down one aisle, and I got to the aisle that I was looking for something, and the shelves were bare, and it was a dead end. And so I turned around, and I went down the other aisle, searching again, and what did I arrive at? A dead end. And I repeated this a number of times. Dead end, dead end, dead end. That same day, Governor Evers had made the announcement about the closures throughout the state. And I felt as if the grocery store was being flooded with all kinds of people. And as I was there in the store that day, I noticed that there was a bit of, I don't want to say panic, but there was again a heightened awareness and concern. And as I watched other people, they started to toss things into their cart. Well, I couldn't find the things on my list, but I saw people grabbing a lot of things, and I thought, well, I'm not gonna miss out on this. And so I too, all of a sudden, started to grab a lot of stuff and toss it in the cart. You know, I almost felt as if I had to do it to survive. I almost felt as if I was in that show on cable TV, Naked and Afraid, like I have a fig leaf and a machete and I've got to go out and scrounge for grubs and cook up an iguana. I mean, I was running through the store like crazy trying to find items. I just began to toss them in my cart left and right. Well, I pushed it up to the front of the store, trying to get out of there as quickly as I could, and I noticed they were about 10 deep at the counter. But then there's an elusive self-scanner. And so I went over to the self-scanner, positioned my cart right up next to it, and then standing before me was this big old sign that read as follows: in order to preserve and make sure that everyone has equal opportunity at items, we are permitting you to purchase 3 perishable items and 3 non-perishable items. And at that point, I had hit that point of the maze and was stuck again. Again, the maze. Well, sometimes when we're in those mazes, we don't know if we're going to get out. And sometimes the doorway seems kind of low or kind of narrow, and we're not certain, are we? Our gospel story this morning, or this day, is that of Lazarus' tomb. And I have a little sideline story, something you might not know about me, but I spent some time in Lazarus' tomb, had the opportunity. Was in the Holy Land taking tours, and we had the opportunity to go to Lazarus' tomb. And as I was emerging from Lazarus' tomb, and my head still hurts today thinking about Lazarus' tomb, as I got up to the top step, and the daylight was shining in through this narrow doorway, and I couldn't quite see what I was doing, I bumped my head. And I believe that the Hebrew word for head is noggin, because I had quite a big bump on my noggin as I tried to wander out of Lazarus' tomb. In fact, if those people that were with me did not help me out, I still could be there today. But I've been to the tomb. the tomb in our story. And there's no tactful way to say it, and as I jokingly talk about hitting my head, but there's no tactful way to say it, but in that tomb, in that place, Lazarus was laid to rest. He had died. Jesus knew it beforehand. Lazarus was dead. Dead. Wrapped in burial cloth, laid in the tomb, dead. And so you can almost imagine the state of mind that the sisters are in, and the friends of Mary and Martha and Lazarus are in, about the fact that he has died. You know, all of us are navigating new ways these days. I keep on hearing of creative solutions that people are offering. I also hear about times that people are frustrated about what's going to happen next. We also have made reference to the fact this feels sort of like a tomb experience, kind of a burial scenario. A lot of things that we were able to do in the past, we simply cannot do. We're in that tomb. You find yourself isolated by choice and not by choice in that tomb. You can't rub your face, can't rub your eyes, can't rub your nose, and heaven forbid you lick your fingers in any form or fashion. You cannot go to work. You cannot travel outside the state. You cannot get your hair cut, nor can you get tattoos. You cannot go to the gym. You cannot eat out. You cannot see your family that might be out of state in person. You cannot. You cannot. Cannot touch. You cannot. This experience is not the norm. And it feels a lot like a death-like experience. And when Lazarus died, it stinks. And what we are going through today stinks, stinks, stinks. We desire it the way it was. And we grieve. We grieve. Before I go any further, again, I just want to, again, orient us to what's going on in this story. Of course, we're talking about Mary and Martha. We're talking about Lazarus. We're talking about locations. Very important, especially because next week is Palm Sunday. And Mary and Martha live in Bethany. Bethany is at the top of the Mount of Olives, actually just a little bit over the crest of the hill. And next week, Jesus, when he makes his triumphal entry, is going to come down the Mount of Olives. Going to probably start up around Bethany, down the Mount of Olives, past the Garden of Gethsemane, going to go down to the Kidron Valley, going to start to ascend up to Jerusalem and Mount Zion. That will be the course. And if we were to go back to Bethany, to the home of Martha and Mary, and we were to look farther to the east, we would notice that there's a road. And that road is rather curvy and windy. And it goes down to one of the lowest places on the face of the planet, to a community called Jericho, just north of the Dead Sea. And if you and I were sitting in the home of Mary and Martha, and we were looking down that road, we could see the travelers coming up from some distance. And so imagine with me the moment that word is sent to Jesus. Jesus says, well, we're going to slow down. I'm going to use this as a glory moment for the Lord and God. And Martha and Mary are wondering, well, we sent word to you, Jesus, where are you? And now they're waiting. And as they're waiting, they're watching. And as they're watching, they see this caravan coming up the hill. And you can almost sense the emotions bubbling to the surface as they're waiting and they're watching. Martha, the impatient one, the one with great frustration, greets Jesus. And the words that she shares are spoken from a time of dealing with pain and loss. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that if you say the word, things can be different. But Lord, come on. If you had been here,
my brother would not have died.
This week I had phone conversations with several of you. One individual shared a story about how they had learned about a former colleague of theirs who had died of COVID. Quite surprisingly so. This past week we heard in the news about a couple that were frightened to the point where they went and took chlorinated chemicals that you would put in a fish tank, thinking that that possibly could be a cure for this COVID situation. People, when they are in grief or are hurting or in pain, do not think clearly. At times they say things that they shouldn't say, and they act in ways that they should not act. It's because of the stress and also the grief. Our minds might be running a million miles an hour. We can't exactly get the words out. We're not sure what to say. And like Martha, we cry out, Lord, come on now. Where are you? If you had been here sooner, things would be different, would they not? It's a lament. It comes from deep inside, and it's real. Some things to be mindful of during this time, and I'm going to label it as grief. Some things to be mindful of. You may have some days that you're going to feel very, very confused. That's grief. You're going to have some days that you're going to be very, very angry. That's grief. You may have periods of despair, utter despair. That's grief. You may cry. You may be weepy. That's grief. You may not feel like eating. You may not feel like sleeping. That is grief. And you're probably asking the question, why are you calling it grief? Well, it's different than a depressive disorder, which is more chronic, lasts a longer period of time. With grief, it's usually during an assigned period, a time that is very rocky for us, but also one that shall come to pass. As I've shared with you in the past couple of times, I've had these opportunities to talk with you. I talk about the temporal nature of what we're dealing with. And I want us all to be reminded of this situation, that it should not define us, especially as we look at the totality of our life experience. Yes, it's very painful today, but as we look at the number of days and years that we walk this journey of life, this will be one episode of it, not the defining one. And so in the midst of this, I have reason for hope. I have hope especially because of Christ's presence and what Christ says. Did you see what Jesus says to Martha in the situation? Your brother shall rise again. And then she says, well, I know he'll rise at the day of the resurrection. He says, well, I am. I am the resurrection. And I am the life. I am. It doesn't stop there. As Sister Mary is weeping, Jesus comes and he is compassionate. And he sees Mary crying and those gathered at the tomb crying. And Jesus weeps as well. Compassion. During these days, we are called to be people with compassionate hearts. And there may be moments that we are crying, or we may be crying along with our neighbor. But compassion is so central. I close with a story today that recently occurred in a neighboring city up in Appleton. There was a young woman who was the group manager of a shelter for the homeless. And she realized that she was running low on supplies. And so, like many, she ran off to the store. And she had a list of items, and we're not talking extravagant items, we're talking about very specific items for sustenance of those who are homeless. And so, like my experience that I shared with you at the beginning of our time, She went down aisle after aisle, shelf after shelf, looking for items that she desperately needed, and she placed them in the cart. And then she arrived at the dreaded checkout. And this happened to be the same scenario as well, that they were limiting the number of purchases per patron. Here she was at Walmart, stuck in line, having a lot of people she had to take care of. It was overwhelming, and she began to weep, to weep. Those and others in lines next to her heard the young woman crying, started to understand the gravity of the situation, and one person said, "Hey, toss an item over here, I'll take care of it." And another one said, "Yeah, me too. Let me buy some items." And suddenly, the lines around her, hearing of her situation, supported her and purchased the items necessary for the shelter. She could go back to take care of those who were entrusted to her care. This is the power of the Holy Spirit, my friends. The power of the Holy Spirit being infused in the lives of strangers, reaching out with love and compassion. The needs of the shelter were met. They became God's hands in the midst of a very dire time. Christ-like compassion. Sometimes we're afraid. Sometimes we are uncertain. But that compassion of another human being towards us is the difference between life and death, or the sorrow or the grief that we are dealing with. Compassion and love. As we find ourselves in our tomb-like experiences, we listen to the words of Jesus. "Lazarus, come out. Unbind him. Set him free." And listen. Christ speaks to us. "Come out. Let me unbind you of your worries and griefs and pains. I am the resurrection and the life. I shall set you free." And dear friends, to that all I can say is amen and amen. Join in song, "Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross." times of restraint and physical distancing, when the body of Christ cannot meet in one place, we gather through the Holy Spirit in our many different places, our home, our apartment, a room that we occupy. And we call now to you, O Lord, to hear our prayers. Give courage and wisdom to our national government and local authorities to enforce public health for the welfare of all, and increase efforts to stop the spread of the virus that affects every human being in this land. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Breathe a spirit of love, O Lord, and self-discipline into your church, that it continually promotes and protects regulations and restrictions for the well-being of all. Strengthen our witness to embody examples of compassion and self-restraint. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God of mercy, heal the sick. Strengthen the elderly and those vulnerable. Protect us all from the spread of COVID-19. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, have mercy, support, and protect all healthcare workers, all who serve the sick, all those in high-risk vocations. Remember particularly refugees, those serving them, those in hospitals, those in long-term care facilities, those at home. Reinforce all agencies that support the health of our people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Send now your Holy Spirit to renew your church. Be with those who are having tomb-like experiences. May we be like Lazarus, resurrected from our times of despair. May we be compassionate like you, Jesus, as we reach out to our neighbor and care for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Trusting in your great compassion and your unconditional promise always to be with us, we pray the words you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive this blessing. Now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Holy God, speaking, spoken, inspiring, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, bless you and unbind you and send you in love and peace. Amen. Our closing song this day speaks of Christ's compassion and love. What wondrous love is this?
Love you.
peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God. I offer words again of gratitude and thanks for our worship occasion this day. A special thank you to Los in accompaniment and Ryan on the technical side, which we would not be able to do without their help. God bless both of them, and God bless you and keep you until we meet again. Peace and blessings in Christ's name. Amen.